Father, as we worship you by listening to your word and carefully attending to it and considering what it says, and Father, I just pray that you'd be pleased with how we respond to it. And Father, we know that our effort is not sufficient to plumb the depths of what your word says or really even to hear from you. Father, that's a miraculous dialogue that takes place when you speak to us and we respond. So, Father, we're counting on today that your Holy Spirit is just going to speak to us and teach us, and that we'd be willing to handle and accept hard truths. We'd be willing to struggle with things that are different than we've heard or believed before. We would be more than just those who hear and consider and ponder and discuss things, but, Father, we'd be doers of this word. And, Father, we know that, again, that takes more than just our effort, but I pray our effort would not be lacking today. We would try hard to hear what you're saying. We try hard to know what you want. We would try hard to do what you say. But Father, we do all that trusting that your Holy Spirit is empowering it all, communicating you and exposing us, whether it's a false thing we have believed or whether it's a behavior that we're engaged in or whether it's an attitude that doesn't please you. Father, we're trusting that. Whether it's encouragement that we need, or just the power to do what it is we're supposed to do. Father, we look to you for those things today. And Father, may the sowing of the seed of this word yield the fruit that pleases you and that makes a difference to the people around us. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we look at this passage today, and you can go and open your Bible if you got it with you, and if not, you can follow along on the screens behind me or in your notes. It's Romans chapter 2. Let me say this as sort of a preemption to the message. Some messages, honestly, are more dangerous than other messages. And when I say more dangerous, I'm not saying dangerous because the teaching is something odd or peculiar or teeters on the edge of heresy or neo-orthodoxy or anything, or just that it's strange to our hearing. I'm talking about the sort of truths in Scripture that are dangerous to hear because they have such profound implications. Because if you hear this and you really understand what he's saying and you really let it sink in and all the veins that this could run in, when you really consider that, you cannot honestly just stay the same. It has to have some effect. Because if it doesn't have effect, I mean, that becomes a very dangerous spiritual practice to hear truth and then shrug it off. Because eventually, you just become indifferent to it. Eventually, you'll get to the point where Scriptures don't penetrate anymore because you hear enough that you don't do, so it just doesn't stick. And, you know, certain kind of messages are really easy to do that with. If the majority of messages that a person hears in a lifetime are primarily aimed at self-help, practical benefits, 6 ways to be happier at work, 4 ways to have a better marriage, 3 ways to find your joy in the routines of life, whatever it may be. You know, it's pretty easy to shrug those off. You just pick and choose which of these little application points are helpful to you, which little phrase is worth you writing down and sticking on your refrigerator this week, what you will use and what you'll not use. Sort of like going through and just picking from a farmer's market of, helpful phrases. But when the focus is on the awesomeness of God, when you begin to see, as Paul is teaching, as Scripture is revealing through the book of Romans, that the focal point here is really not you. It's really not me. It's really not ultimately about us. That salvation is of the Lord. And when we understand it rightly, we stand back and we say, wow, whether figuratively or literally, that wow, God, that you would do this for me, as undeserving as I am. And that doesn't mean to diminish you. I mean, I love me like you love you, and I love you not as much as you love you, but we love each other. We want to encourage one another. But it really is not about how awesome we are. It's about how awesome God is. And really, and pardon my bully pulpit for a moment, so much of what's wrong in the way we approach God in churches today is we do make it all about us. We do make it all about what makes me feel a certain way, what helps me deal with a certain thing, how I think about a thing. Does it agree with me already? I find it amazing how many times folks will just so profoundly applaud a message they hear that agrees with something they've always believed, but when it challenges something they've heard, all of a sudden they've got questions and doubts. Listen, this is about the awesomeness of God. You know, when everything gets to be about you and you perceive all scriptures are just self-help lessons for you, well, it's no wonder that you would come to church saying, how did that make me feel today? Did I like that song? Did I like that illustration? Did he say anything helpful to me? But when I'm hit with the staggering reality of my absolute and utter need for God and what God did for me in Jesus Christ, and I'm hit with the staggering awesomeness of the gospel and how he saved me, that changes everything. And truthfully, when that happens, I don't need good songs to worship him. I don't even need good sermons to do that. I don't need a comfortable chair anymore. I just need to take the time and to pause and say, God, thank you for saving me. Thank you what you've done for me. And it's kind of ironic as we go through Romans, and I'm reading it and rereading it, what I've already covered and what I'm going to cover and trying to make sure everything fits together, because Romans is a unified whole. It's not 20 or 30 or 60 individual life lessons that we can just sort of take and pick and choose from. It is a continuous story, a continuous theme of how God redeems us and why. As I read this, and I'm going backwards and going forwards through these first few chapters, it kind of struck me this week. Paul spends an awful lot of time trying to prove how bad we are. And he really does. I mean, I'm looking for these themes, what I'm going to preach on, and I thought, wow, this is really kind of repetitive. I mean, I get it already, God. I'm an awful sinner. And I wonder, I started to think this, why do you think Scripture devotes three whole chapters to making it imminently, really incredibly clear of our great need for God and our great sinfulness? And it just dawned on me. Because the natural human reaction, maybe to varying degrees, but I would say common to all of us, is this, is to deny how bad we really are. I mean, most people, if not all people, want to cling to some sense of inherent goodness. I'm not really that bad. I'm really a pretty good person. There's good within me. You know, I just need to let the good out. I'm really a good person. I'm a decent person. I'm not like those people. I'm not like that. I don't do those things. I'm a good person. And here's what happens. This sort of spiritual equation begins to take place, whether we perceive it or not. To the degree that we overemphasize our own goodness, to the same degree, we will de-emphasize God's glory and God's greatness and God's mercy. And as a result, the gospel itself doesn't grow in value to us. It decreases in value to us. But to the degree I see myself honestly in Scripture, my incredible need for God, not self-deprecating, not so I can leave here with my head hung low and feeling horrible about myself, but so I can leave here praising God that he loves me and accepts me. To the degree that I see my great need and I see what he's done for me and I see the vast disparity between the righteousness of Christ and my own lack of righteousness, then that gospel becomes more and more beautiful to me. Then God's grace becomes more and more weighty and worthwhile to me, and that really fuels all my worship. So here we are in chapter 2, where Paul starts with these words, therefore. Now, of course you know, because you're good students of the word, when you see therefore, it's a connecting word. It's a bridge to something. Paul's continuing an argument, a proposition that he's already laid out. And that proposition is essentially this from chapter 1. Because people rejected the Creator, because they refused to acknowledge him as God and worship him as such, not just acknowledging that he is a God and he's an awesome God who does incredible things, but I owe my life to him. I have to surrender my life to his authority. Because they didn't acknowledge him as God or worship him as God, their minds become broken. Their thinking is not correct. Their hearts become dark. And when you don't believe in God and you don't acknowledge God as supreme, really what Paul is laying out in chapter 1 is any sort of sin is possible, any sort. And he may emphasize some more than the others, and some give a more extreme example of human depravity or fallenness away from God, but they all fall from the same source. They all spring from the same root, and that's unbelief. I'm just not acknowledging that God made me. God has his right to rule me and tell me how to live. So anything is possible. And then he ends chapter 1 with something that, if we really consider and don't just read over or gloss over, ought to hit us like a spiritual ton of bricks. He says, those who do these things, that laundry list of sins, that laundry list of things that anyone can do who is turned away from the Almighty and denied him his authority in their life, he says, those people who do these things deserve death. They deserve death. People wonder, was it fair? Is it fair? Is it fair that God could judge someone who's never even heard the gospel? Is it fair? And then we look at this story of man's fallenness and we say, you refuse to see and you refuse to acknowledge and you refuse to worship and you turn to your own desires. You live like you wanted to. You made yourself king. If you had a God, you made him up and he served you. You didn't serve him and you went after all of these things. How can you say, is my judgment fair? And for those of us who wonder, is death a fair sentence? Is everlasting death a fair sentence to sin? Think about who we've sinned against. I didn't break my neighbor's rake. I didn't wreck my best friend's car. I didn't throw my shoe at the local councilman in a meeting. I didn't threaten the president of the United States. I defied the Almighty, the Creator. What sentence would be sufficient to that? And so he says, these people who sin, they deserve death. And then he throws this in, which is like, oh, for all the rest of us who don't find ourselves on that list. We say, I have not hated God. I've not invented evil. I've not disobeyed my parents. Not only those who do them, but those who approve of them deserve it too. And that's how he can start chapter 2 this way. Therefore, you have no excuse. Therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. It's hard to proclaim your own innocence when you've dissected the sins of others, so it at least shows that you know what sin is. You know, when you look at Romans chapter 1, you say, yeah, look at that, those people who live like that. That's terrible. Can't believe people do those things. The very fact that you can diagnose that you can spot sin in someone else shows that you at least know what it is, and that by itself makes us culpable for our own. He says, we know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who do such things or who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you're storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil. The Jew first, and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good. The Jew first, and also the Greek. For God shows no partiality. Imagine, if you will, if this was not a letter. Imagine instead if this were a sermon that Paul was giving. And of course, like Paul typically did in most of the cities where he went to, his audiences were primary Jewish people. He taught in the synagogues. He taught where people gathered. And of course, the early church's foundation was Jewish believers who then reached out once they realized that they could and should reach out to their Gentile neighbors. So imagine if Paul is preaching this sermon and starts in Romans chapter 1, and he's speaking to this Jewish audience. And he starts talking about the condition of the world that they live in. And he starts talking about how broken things are and how bad things are and how sinful things are. And then he starts actually naming some sins. I can just imagine as he gets to chapter 1, he starts talking about, you know, these insolent people, these rebellious people, these inventors of evil, these ones who hated God. And I can just envision Paul giving this message on the steps of a synagogue or a public forum, and before long, he's getting amens. Now, I'm not sure if that's exactly what they would have said, but, you know, you tell them. Speak it, preacher. Walk around it. You know, he's telling them. You know, he's getting the feedback. They're all saying yes. They all agree with him. Until he gets to chapter 2 and then makes it clear that who I'm really talking about is you. And the place goes stone cold silent. And now all of a sudden the people aren't affirming what Paul said, but now they're giving him the death stare because they're offended. Because see, this is how Jews saw the world then. They saw themselves in a unique and special position because God had made them promises. God had given them the law and given them a covenant. And as long as they had that promise, as long as they could display that they're Jews, they've been circumcised after all, then we're good to go. And plus, they thought of themselves generally as good and moral people who didn't do the same sort of things that they imagined the whole pagan world did. So when Paul's speaking about evil and brokenness in the world and depravity, they're saying, yes, this world, you're exactly right, but thank God we're Jews and we're not like that. And Paul says, but you are. You too are like that. You see, Jews saw the world like this. There's us and all of them. That's why when Scripture says to the Jew first and also to the Greek, it's not talking about just two very small or narrow people groups. It's talking about the Jews and everybody else, the Gentiles. Of course, they imagine everyone else to be evil. But in this passage of Scripture, there's two truths that just rise to the surface about God's judgment. The first one is this: God's judgment is certain. It's certain. Do you suppose, the Scriptures say, do you suppose that you will escape this? Do you suppose that you'll escape God's judgment? I know it's not the sort of place we like to start spiritual conversations with people we know who aren't believers yet. But the reality is, at some point, an honest gospel conversation has got to include the reality of the sovereignty of God and His right to judge. Everyone is going to stand before Him one day. Do you suppose you'll escape this? But what Paul makes even clearer is not just that God's judgment is certain for everyone, certain and sure, but that God's judgment applies to everyone, to immoral people, like we see listed in chapter 1. And again, you could add to that list. It's not meant to be an exhaustive list of man's sins. It's a representative list. Immoral people are going to be judged, but also moral people. Moral people are going to be judged. It's as if Paul is saying to them, I'm talking about you. Freud identified this ability that we have, this tendency that we have to be critical of everyone but ourselves, this ability we have to be harsh in our judgments about everyone and very lenient on ourselves. He called that projection. Of course, the Apostle Paul really talked about that many centuries before. This ability to see something in someone else we just don't recognize in us. The ability to spot other people's sins very clearly but be virtually blind to our own. Or even the ability, and this is something that's particularly vexing for me, I think, as a Christian. I may not do most of the things that are on that laundry list of sins in chapter 1, but how many of those things do I give approval of? You say, well, I don't approve of those things. But yet you buy tickets to watch movies about those things. Yet you fill your head with television shows full of those things. Yet your humor and conversations have those things. Or are we not giving implicit, if not explicit, approval to those things by how we treat them? As if we act as if those things don't matter? And the judgments are the same? But these religious people, he says, I'm talking about you. And here's a picture really of what hypocrisy looks like. It's a group of people who see themselves as more moral than everybody else and are quick to judge and condemn, but never see it in themselves. There's one theologian said this. He said, we gain a vicarious satisfaction from condemning in others the very faults we excuse in ourselves. This device enables us simultaneously to retain our sins and our self-respect. It's a convenient arrangement, but also slick and sick, he says. That's what hypocrisy looks like. And so Paul is speaking to moral people. Now let's move from history lesson to modern application here. The Jews saw themselves as unique. They had the law. They saw themselves as more moral than their Gentile peers and contemporaries because they were pagan. They worshipped all these false gods. They had all these godless practices. What about us today? Do we not have a tendency also to see the world in such specific sort of terms? These distinct separations? Whereas us, I mean, we're good folks, right? We're good people. We're family people. We try to do the right thing. We're honest in our businesses. We're, you know, we're hardworking. We have conservative values. You know, we try to do what's right. You know, just good folks. Like you hear people say all the time, lots of good folks around here. Those good folks that so easily spot the sins in others but don't see the sins in themselves. Those good folks who don't value the gospel so much because they don't feel like they need it that much. Here Paul is saying, listen, to the worst of us as we perceive the worst, to the best of us as we perceive the best, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And so as you're applauding me talking about the sins of them, don't you realize you're condemning yourself? And that's why when you get to chapter 3, Paul could say something like this. What then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we've already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. As it is written, none is righteous. No, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they become worthless. No one does good, not even one, nine times. How emphatic is that? So here's the reality. Everybody, no matter how you perceive of your relative goodness, no matter how you think you compare with the rest of the world, everybody will face a certain judgment. And this judgment that we face will be fair. It'll be fair. God will judge us fairly and rightly. I mean, look at what the scriptures say. Look at some of these phrases for a second. Verse number two. Do you know the judgment of God rightly falls? It rightly falls. He judges things as they are. That is clear. But you know, God's judgment, one of the reasons that it's fair, one of the reasons we can't say, God, it is not fair for you to judge our sins. One of the reasons we know that it's fair and Scripture describes its fairness is this. It's fair in that it hasn't even begun yet. It's preceded by kindness and patience. We're not feeling the effects of judgment yet. You say, well, this world is a broken mess. Yes, it is. Sin has its own consequences. Romans 1 teaches us that already. Sin has built-in consequences. Thankfully, God is still restraining sin. When we say mankind is depraved, that's not saying he's as bad as he could be. But he's bad enough that he's completely lost and can't reach God on his own. But no, thankfully, we have a God still at work in this world, or God knows how things could be. But so we live in this condition where things are so broken and sin has its own consequences, yet God is still withholding his judgment. In fact, he says it's kindness and repentance. Why? Because God wants you to turn from sin to him. And he's giving time because he's patient and he's merciful. But here's the real challenge for us. The very fact that people presume on that, the very fact that people say, look, I don't see any judgment coming. I got plenty of time to make this right, if they even think about making it right. The very fact that people presume on God's goodness instead of being sensitive to sin, and sensitive to his Holy Spirit and confessing it, that by itself shows the hardness of an impenitent heart, a heart that won't turn from sin. How does that affect a Christian today? A Christian who lives in perpetual sin, a cycle of sin, who is doing these same sins over and over with this bizarro, non-biblical notion, well, one day I'll get this right. One day God will forgive me. That does not show an understanding of grace. What that demonstrates is a hard, cold, impenitent heart. In this same world, as it looks around and says, I don't see judgment. I see wicked people thriving. I mean, I've got competitors in business that are cheats, and they're doing great. They do better than I do. I've got somebody who's always cutting corners at my office, or, you know, I know this guy who's cheating on his wife, or whatever, and the list just goes on. And where's the judgment? Listen, God is merciful. And not only is he waiting for them to repent, but here's something else I believe. He's waiting for the church to do its job. I'm waiting for you to tell them who I am and the judgment that is to come and to turn from judgment and turn to me. He's waiting on that. Not only is it preceded by kindness and patience, as we see in verse 4, but God's judgment and the foundation of all of God's justice, the foundation of God's holiness, is exact retribution. I want you to write that phrase down. That's an important theological phrase. God judges based on exact retribution. How do we know this? What does he say in verse 6? He will render to each one according to his works. Think about this for a second. When judgment comes and God renders that final verdict of judgment, it is not just some sweeping, all have sinned. And so all of you go over there. Well, I don't want to get caught up in that crowd. I'm not like these guys. I'm not as bad as him. That's not how judgment works. It's exact. He will render, he will pay back to every individual person according to that individual person's works. It's exact. That's what makes it fair. So we have all sorts of questions on this side of the equation. Is it fair that God would do these things? But I promise you, when you stand before him and the unfolding of exact retribution for every work that we have done begins to pour out, no one will be crying, "That's not fair. That's not fair." Because it will all be so clearly laid out. In fact, he says this will all happen on what Scripture calls the day of wrath. The day of wrath. And here's something you need to know about the day of wrath, by the way. Sometimes we have this picture of this final day of judgment that we're going to stand before the Almighty. And maybe you have this idea that somebody planted in your head one day, or you just came up with yourself, that like the scales of justice, God will be there and he'll take our good and he'll take our bad. He'll put them on the scale. He'll weigh them out. And I think this is kind of how the world tends to think. And if the good outweighs the bad, then we get in, right? It's good and bad. Scales of justice are blind, and or justice is blind, weighs us on an even scale, and we get to go in. Now, maybe you've heard in sort of a revival message, well, that's not how it works. Any on the sin side negates any on the good side, and all sins will cause us to be separated from God. And so on that day, God is going to evaluate all of our sins. It's like he's going to open up that file, as it were, and he's going to look down your list, and he's going to see the things that you have done, and he's going to say, you know what? Guilty. That really is not what Scripture describes. Scripture doesn't describe the day of wrath as the day God's judgment will be decided. The Scripture decides the day of wrath as the day God's judgment will be revealed. That's why the Scriptures teach us that for those who don't believe, they are condemned already. This is not future tense. The person who doesn't have Christ is already under condemnation. They just haven't felt the full outpouring of wrath and fury. That comes at the day of judgment, the day of wrath. And how do we know this? Well, one, Paul says this. Paul says we're storing these things up. The all-knowing God, the God who sees and perceives everything, who knows our thoughts and the motives of our hearts and knows the actions of our life, every wrong deed is being stored up for the day of wrath. And he's going to judge us according to those deeds. Again, a theologian writes on this type of judgment. Why deeds? You know, don't we have a tendency sometimes when we do wrong? We might say this to somebody, we get caught in something, we say, "Oh, but you don't really know me. That's not who I really am." How many of you have ever done that? Don't raise your hand. I don't want to embarrass you. I have. You don't really know me. Here's a good one right here. We expect this one to have play. That's not my heart. That's not my heart. Scripture doesn't work that way. In fact, the Scripture says the opposite. Out of the fullness, out of the overflow of the heart comes the mouth and, of course, all the actions. And so we have this tendency to say, "That's not my heart." But God judges differently. God says to make this fair, okay, to make this indisputable, to make sure that my just judgments are right and good and incontrovertible and indisputable, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to judge your actions. And here's how one theologian describes that and why. I think it's profound. He says, such a public occasion on which a public verdict will be given and a public sentence passed will require public and verifiable evidence to support them. Okay, this is the day of judgment. And the only public evidence available will be our works, what we have done and what we have been seen to do. The presence or absence of saving faith in our hearts will be disclosed by the presence or absence of good works of love in our lives. So in other words, what Paul is saying is this: I am going to judge you on the evidence. I'm going to judge you on what you have said and what you have done, because what you have said and what you have done will point to the reality of who you are. So when you read Romans chapter 2, and all of a sudden you say, wait, we're going to be judged on the basis of works, you might have a tendency to go, "Whoa, hold up. This is totally different from everything I've heard from Romans so far. I thought we were judged on the basis of faith and grace. You know, if you put your faith and trust in Jesus, that's your salvation. Now, is Paul preaching a contrary gospel? You're saved by works?" No. He never said anything about salvation by works. He said judgment according to works. You're judged according to your works, because those works reveal the core. They reveal the truth about us. They reveal what's going on the inside. It's not different from what James said in chapter 2, verse 18. Someone will say, "You have faith, I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and I'll show you my faith by my works." And then in that same argument, verse 20 says, do you want to be shown, you foolish person, that faith apart from works is useless? James is not arguing that you can have faith and not have works, or works not have faith. What he's arguing is any notion of faith that doesn't include action is not real. It's a worthless notion. It doesn't exist. It's not true. And that's not different from what Paul wrote to the Galatians, Galatians chapter 5, verse 6, when he said that it's faith working. That's what counts, not your religious experience of circumcision, not the fact that you don't have it, but that you have the demonstration of faith that works. So let me show you in these next several verses how God's judgments are perfectly fair, indisputable, and righteous. Three questions. Look at verse 6 again. He, God, will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. I'll give you three questions here that make God's judgment perfectly just and clear to us. First question is this: what am I seeking? What am I seeking? What is my heart's desire? What is it that I'm going after with all that I am? Because Paul clearly contrasts these two things. Am I seeking God himself? When he talks about seeking glory, he's not talking about your glory or mine. He's not talking about the praise of men. He's talking about the very notion of God himself. Do I want to know God? God, is it your glory that I'm after, that I might know you? This is eternal life, Jesus said in John 17, that they might know you, the one true God, the only true God, and Jesus that you sent. Am I seeking after God himself? Am I seeking after his honor, which is to say his approval? Am I seeking to please you, God? Do I want to know you, God, and do I want to honor you with my life? Am I seeking that to please you? And this idea of seeking immortality, that's not just those who want to live forever. Everybody wants that. Everybody wants heaven, just not everybody wants a heaven where God is the center. This is talking about seeking the joy of the very presence of God himself. What am I after? Not just going to heaven when I die. Who doesn't want that? But being with God when I die, because that's the reward of my salvation. Heaven's just the arena where it all happens. So Paul is saying, if I'm seeking God to know him, if I'm seeking to please him, if I'm seeking to enjoy him forever, that reveals something about me. But the contrast to that is, am I self-seeking? Am I living for me? Am I doing what I want, what I think will satisfy me? Am I living for my own honor, my own pleasure? Am I, as a result, rejecting the truth now and then following after evil? So what am I seeking? Because that's going to show me something. In fact, it's going to tie directly to the next question. What am I doing? What am I doing? In verse 9, he says there'll be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, Jews and Greeks. But there'll be glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good. Listen, your actions just don't lie. You've probably heard the statement before. Someone shows you who they are, believe them. And I think that's true. When we're standing before God in judgment, and I don't know how God will do it, if he replays everything like a virtual screen for all those at judgment to see, I don't know. But I know when God reveals every action and every word that falls short of his glory, there'll not be a single person that'll stand there in judgment and say, whoa, this ain't fair. Wait up. And the evidence, the preponderance of evidence keeps piling in and in and in. What am I doing? Because what I'm doing shows who I am. Am I doing good? Only those assumed in this passage that are going to be doing good are those who have honored him as creator, submitted to him in worship, and desire him for their hearts and eternity satisfaction. Those will be the ones that do good. And if you can answer the first two questions, you already have the answer for the third. Where am I going? Because what I'm seeking is dictating what I'm doing, and what I'm doing right now is showing where I'm going. Now listen, there are a lot of passages in Scripture I get that can be kind of controversial, and we can say, well, that's just how you interpret it, or, you know, I know someone else who interprets it this way, or I heard a sermon like this, or I read a book like this, and, you know, I'm not sure exactly what that means. There are some of those, I grant, that we would say are kind of gray. Some things that we might hold with a bit of an open hand and say, you know, we just can't really be sure. This is not one of them. Because when all is said and done, the world is divided into two camps, and that's it. Two camps. That's how Paul leaves this. That's how Scripture leaves it. On one camp, there's eternal life and all that that entails. In the other camp, there's wrath and fury, and there's no way that you can explain that away. You just can't. You can't have a God who is one or the other, not both. There's eternal life. There's wrath and fury. And so the question is, where are you going? And I would say where you're going is already showing based on what you're doing. And what you're doing is a direct result of what you're seeking, what you want the most. So when you think about this for a moment, heavy themes, the judgment of all people, the judgment of every living person without, as Scripture says, partiality, everybody, the indisputable judgment that's fair and just because it's every single thing. Things we're doing, they're just storing up. God is not ignoring them. He's not condoning them. He's just waiting for that single day to come where judgment is not decided but revealed. If this is true, it ought to shake you to your very core if you don't know Christ. It ought to break your heart for the people that you watch a ball game with or have a picnic with or share lunch with today that don't know Christ, because this is real. You can't just walk away from this and say, oh, I'll take those two self-help points and I'll leave the rest. It just is. What do you do with this? You see, when you understand this reality, wrath and fury and judgment, that's right and good, it's specific to my sins, it's indisputable, it's incontrovertibly fair. When you get that, now all of a sudden do you see how the gospel becomes so elevated in worth and value that God demonstrates his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Sometimes the worst of the worst, they get it better than the best of the best. You just have to convince them that God could love them, and he can, because God's a much better Savior than you are a sinner. Sometimes the hardest crowd to reach is those who think they're good enough already. Paul hits that head on. Everybody everywhere is going to face this judgment. What will you do? I'll tell you what you'll do. It's found in those verses we read at Lord's Supper earlier. I'm not ashamed of the gospel, Paul said. You see why I'm so bold to tell you how bad you are, Paul said? Do you see why I don't shirk back from telling you Jews your circumcision is not enough? Your possession of the law is not enough? Being a recipient of the covenant, not enough. Why I don't mind telling this pagan world how you've lived will send you straight to hell and face the wrath and fury of God. Do you see why I'm not ashamed of telling you those hard things? Why? Because I've also got the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, Jews and Greeks. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed. What is this righteousness? Let's hear it one more time. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe, for there's no distinction. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So everybody needs this righteousness. And are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. Everyone can receive this righteousness as a gift. What did Christ Jesus do? God put him forward, verse 25, as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. That's like chapter 2. God's storing them up. He's storing them up. He's showing his mercy, wanting you to repent. He's holding off. It was to show his righteousness at the present time. He does deal with sin. You don't want a God who doesn't care about sin, do you? Do you want a God who doesn't care about evil? No, of course not. We want a righteous and holy God. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that, and here's the awesome conclusion, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith. You see this? I don't want you to miss this. We're going to close. Only at the cross do you see the perfect convergence of every attribute of God. That God is just. I will punish sin. Sin will be punished. Every sin. And the reality is this, my sin will be punished in Christ already, or my sin will be punished in me at the day of wrath. But God is just. Everyone will face his judgment because he's just. If he does not judge sin, he's not God. There's certainly not any sort of God worth worship. He is just and will judge sin. But God is more than just. God is a justifier. God is the one who makes sinful people right with him. Sinful people don't make themselves right with the just judge. He makes them right. How does he do it? By revealing his righteousness. Not a righteousness that can be earned, not a righteousness that can be purchased, but a righteousness that can be received by faith, because Jesus is our righteousness. So the best of Jesus is given up for the worst of us at the cross. And in punishing Jesus, God shows he's just and a justifier of all who believe in him. That's just how it is, folks. Which will it be? What are you seeking? What are you doing? And where are you going? Those reveal your heart, but it's not too late to change that. Listen, if you're a Christian today, celebrate the good news of the gospel, what Jesus has done for you. If you're not, receive it today. Receive it today. Make this today. You say, God, take away my sin and give me life. I want to exchange what I've done for what Jesus did for me. I want a different future, and I definitely want a different eternity. I want to make Jesus my Savior today. Will you close your eyes and pray with me this morning?